Is there anything advice-wise you can give to drum techs out there nowadays? I mean, it's a whole different world. A lot of these guys are trained through, you know, educational programs. Some of them are just picked up and kind of thrown into it. A lot of them are drummers. But coming from the roots that you did, you know, laying the foundation for drum teching, I know that you might take that as a modest compliment, but I feel that you did. You know,
well, thank you.
You and a crew of other people have done it, but what would you tell the drum techs nowadays that can kind of set in as a mindset for them to get into?
Man, I don't know. There's a lot of good guys out there that are doing a great job. Mm-hmm. I met so many cool guys that are way younger than me. One of them works for Aerosmith, and another one works for, I think the guy that works for Chad Smith of the Chili Peppers. There's, of course, my old buddies, Jeff Jonas and Harry McCarthy. They're just incredible techs. And I don't know, man, the young guys out there. I had guys ask me, not as many now as the old days. They'd say, well, how do you become a drum tech? And I said, well, you can do what I did, have your drums burned down in the fire and be depressed and not have any money to buy a new set and go on tour with the band.
Yeah.
Come with us. You're depressed. Come with us. So,
yeah, different.
That's what happened to me. My drums burned down. I was depressed. And so, I didn't know where I was going anyway. I mean, I started. Yeah,
so they hired you to come out and start.
Yeah, that band Snail, Ron Fillmore, that I talk about a lot. I mean, I thank God for them. They took me with them and said, well, here, you just work for us. Do this work, you know, and it got me.
Yeah, but in all fairness, you're the one that sort of stepped up and had that mindset that we talked about earlier about you're not going to just set up the drums and walk away and when
no.
the show's over, pack them up. You're going to sit there and say, how can I make this better tomorrow?
Yeah.
And how can I fix this and how can I make this run smoother?
Right.
That's the difference, I think.
There's two things that always crack me up about great drummers. And one of them was this guy that used to, that band Rare Earth. Man, that was such a great band. And that drummer also did the vocals.
Okay.
And he was a great player. And we did this huge gig in Monterey Fairgrounds. And he was there, that band, and the Snail band with Ron Fillmore. And I heard him talking, man, I got to change the snare head. It sucks. And you know, I think it was cracked or something and ripped or something. I said, well, I'll do that for you. He says, well, who are you? I said, well, I'm drum roadie for this band here. He says, nah, I'll do it myself. Why can't I do it? Well, you know how to do it? Change a drum head? He says, well, what I mean by that is, you know how to put that new head on there and make sure it's seated right and doesn't, you know, rip because you got it. Why don't you let me do it? So he sat there and watched me. And I took the other one off. I cleaned the whole drum up, put the new head on, and tuned it up and all that. He says, I've never seen that happen before besides a drummer doing it.
Yeah.
And I thought that was so weird. Well, wait a minute. Don't you have a crew, don't you? He says, that guy doesn't touch my drums. I don't want him touching my drums.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I just drank my Jack Daniels and said, well, wow, that was weird. And then I remember Bonnie Raitt even saying, she was on the gig too, she says, well, I don't understand what the big deal about that is. And I'm like, yeah, I'm like, have another Jack Daniels. Well, let's see the big deal. So, but then the other thing was when I worked for Brian Auger, amazing B3 player. Brian Auger, you ever heard of him?
I have heard of him.
Oh, my God. And he had this, you must have heard of Mike Clark.
Yes, absolutely.
I mean, here I am at the Santa Monica Civic. And Mike Clark's the drummer, and I said, so Mike, so I'm gonna change some heads on the drum. Oh, no, don't touch my snare drum. I said, but the head is filthy dirty, way too old, the coating's off, and I doubt if it's gonna last the night. He says, well, it's lasted for 10 years. I said, you've had that drum head on there for 10 years? And he was serious. And this is the honest to God truth. I had my tools with me. This is the second gig of this tour we're doing. And I could not get the damn drum head
off. I was
going
to say, it's probably...
I used a hammer to hammer on. He came around the corner there. What are you doing? Well, I'm hammering the damn head off. It sucks. It's stuck on here. He says, well, hell, it's been on here, you know. So I hammered it off, and I had to clean all this cognac or whatever the hell. It was all this crap off from the edges and really clean the drum up so I could see the forest of the trees. And then I put the new head on and tuned it up, and he says, oh, it sounds good. Yeah, sounds a lot better, doesn't it, with a new head on? And he says, yeah, well, it'll be another 10 years, and I'll... And I see him a lot, and we reminisce. Like, he came to the Chick Corea rehearsal, and I said, do you remember the time we tried to get the drum head off? He said, I remember. Don't embarrass me. I just think that's funny. And then one time, the Stones had a snare drum from the Steel Wheels tour, and they're getting ready to go do something. And my friends who worked for the Stones said, you're not going to believe this head that's on Charlie's drum, you know. Another one of these things, you had to hammer it off, you know. Stuff stuck in there, like, I mean, it's kind of repulsive what you see in there, like mm-hmm. 2 years of meals,
right, right.
God, whatever else. Yeah. I can't get into that. Ah. But the thing is, it was kind of foreign to these guys because they would play the drum till it broke.
Yeah.
Like you'd see these things, like you know the Ludwig throw out. They either run the little cording through to hold the snares on and tie it, or like the thing that holds clamps it, the screws would be missing, and they just and you'd wonder, why don't you just go to the hardware store and get some new screws? They didn't think that on their day off they were going to go to a hardware store, and so the roadie, you know, if he cared, when most of them didn't, they just, why would I help them? Well, I got to get a new tube. Well, if you got to get a new tube for an amp, and you got to solder something, fix something that breaks on an amp, why would you not want to take care of the drums that way too? So for me, it was like a pride thing. I better take care of this guy.
That's the advice for the young guys out there. Take pride in what
you're doing. And you know what? I'm going to say this, and I know it's going to sound arrogant. Cleaning cymbals is not taking care of a drum kit. You want to have polished cymbals, groovy, but that has nothing to do with taking care of drums. In fact, the other day, I loved it when they asked Tommy about his cymbals. Tommy Igo, amazing drummer. They asked him, he says, why would I do that? And I remember once at Paul's Mall in Boston where I met Vinny Caliota and Steve, he had this beautiful 24-inch ride and he really loved it. It was not old, but it wasn't new either. And I said to Billy, okay, I'll polish that cymbal for you. He says, do never polish my cymbals. Okay.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Because I was getting the brass all out, and I was getting ready to clean that up. Because it's bronze is organic. It's got, I know this sounds really wacko. Are you an acid? But they have a soul to them. Drums and cymbals, they all have a soul to them. You know, it's like, what do you want? And so I noticed a lot, and I'm not condemning them or criticizing, but it seems to be a lot of emphasis. It's kind of like some of our kids nowadays, emphasis on the outer and not on the inner.
Yeah,
and they're like cleaning these cymbals and they're like, see, look what I did. What did you do? Yeah. Did you help the dynamics of the drums today? Well, no, but I polished the cymbals. I didn't help the cymbal at all.
Yeah. The only person that's really going to see that is the drummer anyway.
It's all about cosmetics, the outward thing, instead of the core, you know, like we're the core of the drums. I mean, to me, the bass drum, man, oh, this mic needs to be... The bass drum's got to sound great. The tom's got to sound great. The cymbals don't have to look... who cares what they look like? They're played. They're not... It's a plain.
I prefer to see worn cymbals. They have character.
Yeah.
Something too exactly perfect and
polished. That's the perfect word, character.
I've got a 22-inch Zildjian Ping at home that I refuse to clean because the character is in the... It's all... There's a big, nasty spot in it from fingerprints, but it sounds beautiful. And I would completely screw it up if I cleaned it. I won't touch it.
In fact, Tommy was saying something... Yeah. Similar to that, he had a ride or something that had a big rust stain on it.
Yeah, like his roof leaked and spot is green.
And now it's a patina that's forming on the cymbal. And the guy wanted to clean it. He's, no, don't touch that! Yeah. That was pretty cool. I agree. I think cleaning drums, I mean, the best way I learned how to take care of drums was I would clean them to see what was going on with them. That's where you see where cracks are. You see where something.
Would you strip everything down to just the shell? I mean, how crazy?
No,
would you
just get the, like on the Billy's drums, the Fives drums. I would just take a chamois.
Yeah.
And just clean the dust off them and all that. And now they have all kinds of polishes. They have all these polishes you can use to clean it and then polish it. They didn't have anything like that then. I called the guy up at Fives once, and I said, "So do you have like something to rub these out?" And he says, "What's that mean?" I said, "Rub them out, scratches and all that."
In your T-shirt.
Yeah.
Get 100% cotton
swab. Sneeze on them, maybe that'll help. I don't know. Cheese? No, what? So, I mean, I was using rubbing compound.
Magic eraser.
Waxes out on tour. Yeah. I never used. That was the other thing. Like the thing for roadies back then was, man, I stopped at the truck stop. They had this really cool shit called, you know, Never Doll. It's what the truckers use. It's this cotton wad you pull out of a tin.
Yeah.
That's what they use to clean brass and chrome and copper. So I remember carrying a can and Never Doll around, and I never would open it up. I'd smell it and go, oh, God.
Awful.
And they'd say, oh, yeah, use that Never Doll, man. That really cleans those cymbals up. And I'm saying, why would I want to clean these cymbals up?
Yeah.
That one was owned by Tony Williams. That one was owned by, why would I want to do that? What?
And we're taking them off.
We're cleaning the history.
Yeah.